దూరవిద్యా విధానంలో డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ ఓపెన్ యూనివర్సిటీ దేశంలోనే మొట్టమొదటి సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం. దాదాపు 2.5 దశాబ్దాలుగా దూరవిద్యా విధానం ద్వారా కంప్యూటర్ కోర్సును అనుసంధానం చేస్తూ బిఏ బికామ్ బిఎస్సీ డిగ్రీ కోర్సులను అందిస్తోంది. పోస్ట్ గ్రాడ్యుయేషన్ స్థాయి డిగ్రీ డిప్లొమా స్థాయి కోర్సులను ఔత్సాహికులైన విద్యార్థులకు అందిస్తోంది. డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం స్థానికంగా స్వయం బోధనా పద్ధతిలో ముద్రణ రూపంలో రూపొందించిన కోర్స్ మెటీరియల్ అందిస్తోంది. కోర్స్ మెటీరియల్ అధ్యయనానికి సహకరించే విధంగా రేడియో టెలివిజన్ పాఠ్యాంశాల ఆధారంగా కార్యక్రమాలు ప్రసారం చేస్తోంది. అధ్యయన కేంద్రాల ద్వారా ఏర్పాటు చేసే సలహా సంసర్గ తరగతులు సైన్స్ ప్రాక్టికల్ సౌకర్యాలు విద్యార్థులకు స్వయం అధ్యయనానికి ఒక చక్కటి అవకాశం. ఇవి విద్యార్థి సమీపంలో ఉండే అధ్యయన కేంద్రం నుంచే పొందొచ్చు.
కనీస విద్యార్హత లేదని బాధపడుతున్నారా? చేతిలో కనీసం ఒక డిగ్రీ అయినా ఉండాలనేది మీ డ్రీమా? ఉన్నత చదువులు చదవాలని ఉన్నా సమయం అనుకూలించడం లేదా? మీలాంటి వారి కోసమే ఈ అద్భుతమైన అవకాశం. అంబేద్కర్ సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం మీకు బాసటగా నిలుస్తోంది. ఎలాంటి కనీస విద్యార్హత లేకున్నా ఉన్నత విద్య అభ్యసించే అవకాశం. బిఏ బీకాం బిఎస్సీ ఈ మూడింటిలో ఏదో ఒక డిగ్రీ 3 ఏళ్లలోనే మీ సొంతం. వయసుతో పని లేదు, అర్హతతో అస్సలు అవసరం లేదు. ఆడుతూ పాడుతూ ఇంటి ముందుకే డిగ్రీ పట్టా తెచ్చుకోండి. మరింకెందుకు ఆలస్యం? యూనివర్సిటీ వెబ్సైట్ను సందర్శించండి.
Hello friends, a very warm welcome to this live teleconferencing on behalf of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University Hyderabad. Today we are going to discuss on the topic capital budgeting for the subject financial management for the students of MBA and also MBA in hospital and healthcare management. In today's live teleconferencing, our topic would be capital budgeting techniques, where we would talk on the need and importance and definition of capital budgeting, need for capital investment decisions, and also different types of capital budgeting techniques like payback period, NPV, IRR, ARR, profitability index, etc. In order to discuss capital budgeting techniques, today we have with us two eminent resource person. We have with us Professor I. Anand Pawar. He is the Dean and Dean Faculty of Commerce and also Head Department of Management, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University. Also we have the second resource person, Dr. Ravi Kumar. He is an Associate Professor and Head, St. Mary's College, Yusuf Guda, Hyderabad. Our resource person would enlighten us for the first 40 minutes. They would discuss on the topic capital budgeting, and the last 20 minutes is for question and answers. And I request all our viewers to ask relevant questions on today's topic capital budgeting. To interact and clarify your doubts, you may please dial the following numbers for in the last 20 minutes: 040-270-31431. 040-270-31432, 040-270-31433. I repeat the numbers, dear viewers: 040-270-31431, 040-270-31432, 040-270-31433. Today we are going to discuss on the topic capital budgeting techniques. In the subject financial management, we normally have three important decisions to be taken. One is the investment decision, then comes the financing decisions and the dividend decisions. A financial decision which is concerned with a firm's fund, which has to be inverted in different types of asset, is what is called as an investment decision. Investment decision may be long-term decisions or short-term decisions. A long-term decision is nothing but a capital budgeting decision, and a capital budgeting decision is involved in our day-to-day lives. We see all sorts of capital budgeting decisions which is involved in a normal day-to-day life. Now, let us ask our resource person, Professor I. Anand Pawar, sir, what is the concept and nature of capital budgeting?
Thank you, Dr. Ranjani. Before we discuss about the topic called capital budgeting, this word, the capital budgeting is made up of two important words, capital and budgeting. Capital is refers to as long-term investment or capital expenditure. And the word budgeting is planning and targeting for profitable returns or higher rate of returns to target the investment made by the firm. And here, when we are talking about the capital budgeting techniques or decisions, we have to understand the basic fundamental role or functions of any financial manager in any organization, whether it is small or big. So, major decisions would be made by a finance manager or identification of financial needs, rising financial finances, and also effective utilization of funds. So, this function, which is made up of two words, capital and budgeting, is referring to third functions of any finance manager. It is allocation of resources or allocation of funds, that is for making profitability. And friends, here when we talk about capital budgeting is a investment decision of the firm, generally known as capital investment or capital expenditure. And these decisions would be made based on the duration of the time, so short term as well as long term. So generally, when we talk about capital budgeting, we consider only long term decisions, therefore we call it as capital budgeting. So capital budgeting means capital expenditure made or deployment of resources to acquire or purchase fixed assets such as land, building, machinery, technology, and so on. So, when we go for purchasing of such fixed assets, which are not repetitive in nature, we call it long-term capital expenditure. So, friends, these all we do by the financial manager to yield future returns. Capital budgeting, deploying financial resources now for yielding future returns. When we planning for such long-term profitable investment, it is known as capital budgeting. And these budgeting, capital budgeting, we consider generally we talk about large size projects which are required quite heavy funds made immediately, and but the returns will be available only after over a period of time. So capital budgeting involves choosing the project that add value to the firm. So whenever we talk about capital budgeting, it is a process and the important decision made by the finance manager, and the process involves like this, that is evaluating the investment, because there are many projects available for the firm in which we have to invest our resources is important decision. So we have to evaluate the available avenues or projects with huge expenses in order to obtain best returns on the investment. So simply we call it long term planning for making and financing proposed capital investments. So this is what briefly about capital budgeting. And to examine the definition given by one of the authors, what would be capital budgeting? It is concerned with allocation of firm's financial resources among the available opportunities, because opportunities are many, but we cannot invest the firm's resources into all the projects. Therefore, the finance manager has to make relevant and suitable decisions which are more profitable investment proposals. So to do so, manager has to undertake lot of exercises based on the situation or financial resources available with the firm. So capital budgeting is allocation of firm's capital financial resources among the projects or available opportunities. So to examine the capital budgeting by now, we can list out few features or nature, we call it as also nature of capital budgeting. So we all of us know, when we talk about capital budgeting, we have to talk about it involves or requires huge funds, large investments. And these investment now we are making into projects which generates future profits, not right now, because it is long term investment. And friends, long term investment is fixed right now, and the returns would not be fixed. It determines the different methods, how to calculate and how to compute which technique gives what kind of returns over a period of time. And then the future benefits are spread over several years, not in a 1 or 2 years. And next feature of capital budgeting is, this is very important, because capital expenditure once made, it is not irreversible. We cannot take back. Therefore, the decisions taken are making before the capital budgeting decisions, one must be very careful. And then the profitability, because when we are investing huge funds, the firms expect huge returns also. So we call it profitability is determined by the quantum of investment, because how much we are investing, to that extent the firm will generate returns. So lower the investment, lower the returns. Higher the investment, higher the returns. So it depends on the all equations which are we are going to apply for capital budgeting decisions. And one more very important nature of the capital budgeting would be, it involves high degree of risk, because any long term investment requires lot of exercise, that is making decisions, because we have to examine what are the probable risks that are going to occur during the project, and particularly when we are generate returns back. So one must be very careful while going for these investments.
Thank you, Professor Anand Pawar, sir. Thank you very much. As sir has rightly said, capital budgeting is nothing but long-term planning. It talks about investments, and it talks about what is the future profits we get about the investments. So we have to, as financial managers, we have to take right decisions at the right time, because capital budgeting investments are long-term investments which involves huge amount of money. If we take right decisions, you get huge amount of profits over longer period of time. A wrong decision will yield us to a huge amount of losses, is what sir has told. In continuation with what Professor Anand Pawar sir has told, let me ask Dr. Ravi Kumar sir, can you sir briefly explain us the objectives of capital budgeting, sir?
As Professor Pawar said, it is a long term in nature, and it is irreversible. Once you commit the funds for the project, you cannot reverse it. So now the capital budgeting technique aims at what are the funds to be committed for a given project, and how much money is required for committing for a given project, and from where we can raise this money, this financial resources, and whether a particular project is viable or not. And if there are competing projects in hand, let us say GMR, if it has the option of investing in multiple airports, now which airport construction or erection is more viable for the company? So when there are competing projects, to evaluate the worth of each project, you need to know, you need to very wisely deploy the capital budgeting techniques. So therefore, capital budgeting technique aims at what type of project is viable, what are the financial resources needed, how we can raise those financial resources, and what is the return that we are going to generate from each project. So this is the aim of employing capital budgeting technique. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi Kumar, sir. Thank you very much. As sir has told, capital budget decisions are irreversible. The moment we take a decision, we cannot get back and the losses what we incur is very huge. And as sir has told, we evaluate the viability of a project, and also we see, like for example, normally we may have two projects, project A and B, and which project to select is all about capital budgeting decisions all about. So may I ask Professor Anand Pawar, why capital investment decisions are important for a firm, sir? And also, can you please explain us the steps in capital investment decisions, sir?
Right. See, capital, importance of capital investment decisions, because decisions always meant for making right choice. Decisions are nothing but coming to a conclusion about a particular project to be undertaken. So when we talk about capital investment decisions and why it is important, is when we call it, when we are investing in a new project, it is very important decision, because the firm is investing its huge funds in a new project. Whether the new project is going to be worthy or not is one important. Whether this decision we are going to make is applicable for upgrading or maintaining the existing assets, for example, land we are acquiring further, for instance, machinery, whether we are replacing or maintaining, and for example, technology, whether we are taking for a fresh or we are upgrading from the existing, and then developing new products. So when we are thinking about these, all these things, the capital investment decisions assume greater significance, because as we already discussed, our I have made a mention about investment is a requires heavy funds, because when we are going for investing huge funds, we must be very careful in which project and what type of project we are going to use or plan for. And another important factor for making investment decision is the whatever we are planning for capital investment decisions, which are affected by long term implications. For example, once you take in a project decision, if anything goes wrong, again it will have impact on other avenues or other projects taken by the same organization. So, and if it is success, the reputation and goodwill of the firm will also go up, and it may attract further more projects from the market. So long term implications it will give, therefore it is important decision. And next one, we already discussed, it is not reversible decision. So when it is not reversible decision, we must be very conscious and we must be very calculative in terms of project that we are going to take up by examining their viability and all that. And therefore it is most difficult task to make investment decisions. And also it is important because the type of capital investment that we are going to employ, whether the projects are mutually exclusive or independent or what type of individual projects, these also determines the role and importance of capital investment decisions by any finance manager of any company. So because of these factors, we consider capital investment decisions are very significant for any firm.
Thank you, Professor Anand Pawar, sir. Sir has very rightly said, capital investment decisions are very crucial for any financial manager of any company. He will decide as to whether should we invest in a project or not, what decisions to be taken, do I buy a machinery or do I replace a machinery. So many important decisions are taken based on the capital budgeting techniques by all the financial managers of the company. And as also, as sir told, there are so many steps which are involved, which has to be kept by the financial manager, which plays a very important role in taking the right decision. As we have been discussing since beginning, any capital budgeting decision is irreversible. As it is irreversible, the financial manager should be very careful before taking any sort of a investment decision.
Excuse me, because we have to discuss about steps, because second question pertaining to discuss what you call it steps, yes, in investment decisions, right?
Yes.
So any project or any activity involves certain steps, and this process is not exemption or what you call exception to capital investment decisions. So as and when firm or the finance manager gets an idea of project, we call it as project idea generation. So this is the first stage wherein finance manager has to identify the potential areas where investments can be made. And this work may be entrusted to a particular departmental committee or within the organization, or experts from the outside which are associating organizations or consultancies. So it starts with idea generation, project idea generation. And second step would be, when we have an idea about projects, we have to develop alternative projects, because with one project we cannot make a decision, because we have to examine viability. So when we talk about viability, we have to examine multiple options or opportunities, means different projects, alternative proposals. So for example, if an organization wants to replace the existing machinery, what type of alternatives we have to go for, whether replace or go for alternative. For example, sometimes replacement of the old machinery may require huge amount than the replacement of new machinery. So what type of activity or asset that we are going to employ, capital budgeting, therefore developing alternatives is important. So either it can be purchased ordinary machinery or automatic machinery also. And the third step would be, after idea generation and developing alternatives, evaluation of alternatives, because we have already have multiple choice or more projects, 2, 3, 4, more than one project. We have to evaluate one by one, its strengths and weaknesses, opportunities and threats. Likewise, we generally employ SWOT analysis for any examination of any proposal.
Correct.
So what we mean to, I mean to say is, when we have multiple projects in hand, that is with the organization, we have to evaluate one project one by one and then estimate the cost outflow required for the proposed investment and then expected benefit out of it. So we have to take two aspects here. One is how much estimated cost outflow that each alternative projects are required, and how much these all alternative projects are going to generate future returns or profits for the firm. Over a period of time, we have to examine. So there are many aspects we consider, but mostly we finance managers focus on these aspects. And then the problem with the estimation of cash flow is always in risky or certainty or uncertainty.
Yeah.
So we have to examine under three conditions.
Yeah.
One is certainty, because the future outcome is well in advance, known well in advance. We know what would be the result. So that is certainty. And sometimes the estimation of cash flow evaluation techniques may be adopted to study the relative profitability of each project. So next point would be uncertainty. Uncertainty is the condition where the situation is not completely in our hands, because we may not probable chances of occurrence. It means either it may happen what we think of like this, or maybe all differently, but not maybe may not be reverse, because the condition where we talk about risk is completely unknown. So while evaluating the alternative project, financial manager has to consider these three components: risk, certainty and uncertainty, because finally a project report will be presented and submitted to the top management, because the finance manager is not going to finalize the decisions regarding investment in capital investment. Because when the finance manager is stating that the cost and benefit involved in each alternative, then only management will able to endorse the proposal made by the finance manager. So this is possible only evaluating all these available projects in the hand, and then we have to select the most suitable project depending on the examination that what we have made already. So selection of a project. So we cannot go ahead with all the projects because of the resources and all that. The organization can take up one project from the available project. So this is, we call it selection of project. In this stage, what we generally consider is, this will be done by the top management or plant engineer or a committee appointed by the management. So this is done at the after finance manager job is little over, because he has taken one project which is viable based on investment and the outflow, that is returns. again it has to go for technical consent, because plant manager or engineer concerned is the right person to endorse.
Yes.
Therefore, before going for further, we have to take this process, and then next to step for capital budgeting decisions would be implementation. Because once it is endorsed by the technical committee and top management, then we have to go for implementation. So that is most crucial stage, immediately immediate implementation of the selected proposal. So because when once this project is selected, we cannot further delay, because undue delay result in cost escalation, so that the profitability of the project may be varying. And therefore, to avoid delay in implementation of the use of mathematical techniques such as capital budgeting techniques like program evaluation, we have some program evaluation techniques, PERT we call it, program evaluation review technique, and critical path method techniques, CPM. So this is what, while implementing a project, we generally we adopt these techniques and see that how we are implementing the project. And last but not the least, performance review. Because once you have implemented a project after taking all care, so performance of the project is also continuous process, which requires monitoring of the performance after the implementation of the project, whether the expected and actual operating results are compared in this process. Because the performance review is nothing but the measuring actuals with standards, are expected and actuals. Therefore, this stage will help the taking corrective actions against the responsible persons or responsible factors. So by taking all these six steps, we can go for capital budgeting decisions. Generally, any organization will take these kinds of steps for making any investment decisions.
Thank you, Professor Anand Pawar, sir. Thank you for explaining the steps involved in capital investment decisions wonderfully. He has explained us from the stage of idea generation, all the six stages, to performance review. Like we use, as sir has told, we use all these capital budgeting investment steps or decisions in our day-to-day life also. For example, we buy a mobile, or our mobile gets repaired, or it gets, we have to repair a mobile, and we always think, do I buy a new mobile, or do I spend some money in repairing a mobile? So all these capital budgeting decisions are also used by us in our day-to-day lives. So may I ask Ravi Kumar, sir, to tell us the various kinds of capital investment decisions taken in day-to-day life by the financial managers, sir?
Yes. As Professor Pawar said, there are six steps from idea generation to review of the project. Actually, in fact, sir, even the Project Management Institute, PMI USA also follows the same series of steps. And they're very particular, you know, in maintaining this. Now, I would like to pull out a second step of your discussion. You are talking about decisions. Decisions, you know, the word decisions arises when there are alternatives. Right. Now, your previous step was deciding alternatives or searching for the alternative. When there are alternatives, then there comes the question of decision making. So when you look at the capital budgeting techniques, you have decisions with related to buy the new kind of asset or to replace it, buy a new one, or just continue or renovate the same asset. For example, we have you know, floods in the state of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, and there are so many ambulances affected and so many hospitals affected. And if you look at the public transportation, RTC, so many buses are affected. Whether we go for the, you know, repair of these equipment and the assets, buses and vans, or the theatrical equipments, or replace them, you know, when they are not in a usable condition, we have to replace them. So you have to decide upon, you have to take a call. That's one. And sometimes, our government also was proposing to increase the number of hospitals. You know, the healthcare system has to be developed, improved. So there, as a result, you know, they are planning to increase the bed size in the existing hospitals, that is expansion. And if you look at the statewide expansion, they want to increase the number of super specialty hospitals. Right. So the decision related to the existing systems, decisions related to the expansions, and sometimes you may be thinking of going for a particular company, may be thinking of going for diversification. All along you have been manufacturing, you have been in the oil industry, refining industry, then suddenly you may think of jumping into IT industry, or later on you may jump into retail sector when you look at those sectors profitable, promising. So the decisions related to diversification also comes. Right. Now there is one more point I would like to reiterate here. There are some projects which are mutually exclusive. I mean to say, if you select one project, you cannot accept another project. Simultaneously, you cannot accept two projects. It is for the fact that the resources, particularly the financial resources, and sometimes the manpower also may be, you know, very limited. You are constrained by your resources. Right. So because of the constrained resources, you are compelled to choose only one project. So there are mutually exclusive projects. So that is the decision involves there. And likewise, sometimes there are some contingent decisions. You have never expected that you will take a decision like that.
Right.
A situation like a pandemic, you know, nobody thought that there would be a lockdown. Nobody thought there will be a suspension of a civil services examination. So companies also sometimes, based on the unseen situations, have to take a call. So this is a contingent decision. So these are types of decisions I would like to say.
Right.
In the capital budgeting decisions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ravi Kumar sir. He has very well explained the various kinds of capital investment decisions, like do we buy, do we replace, do we expand, do we diversify. And also sir has taken real time examples through which our viewers can understand the various investment decisions taken by financial managers. May I now ask Professor Anand Pawar sir, what is the minimum duration for a capital investment decision, sir?
Yeah, rightly said, because the capital investment decisions, generally when we talk about capital investment, is long term, over a period of time, because whenever we call about short term or long term, the capital budgeting decisions are related to long term, that is over a period of time, that is more than 1 year. So the duration of the project, it depends on the project that we undertake or we take up for the implementation. Because some projects may take 1 year to 2 years, it may another some projects may take 5 years, some projects may, for example, you take the irrigation projects, those projects will take more than 5 to 10 years also, sometimes 15 years also. So we cannot decide right now, but the firm has to decide the duration of the project based on the nature of the project, what type of project that company wants to invest. So whether it is plant and machinery, or expansion of existing business, or going for build construction business, or going for any project of power project, any project. See, it depends on the nature and size of the project, which determines the duration of the project. And generally, when we talk about capital budgeting decisions are pertaining to more than a year. Then only we call it as long term decisions. How? For this we employ, there are several techniques available for any business organization, those who wish to invest their resources. And capital budgeting methods or techniques, we refer to, it is also known as methods or techniques. And these techniques are broadly divided into two. One is traditional methods or techniques, and second one is modern techniques. And the traditional techniques, also known as non-discounting methods, and whereas modern methods are discounting factor inverse, therefore it is discounting methods. So under traditional methods or non-discounting methods of capital budgeting, payback period is one method, and second one would be average rate of return. And then when it comes to modern methods, we generally discuss about net present value of the future inflow and outflow, and then internal rate of return, and last one is profitability index. So these are the five methods generally available for any project evaluator or finance manager before going for any investment in long term. Every across the sectors, across the firms, across the business, or any finance manager would adopt either one of these or all of these or combination of two or three, but there is no choice beyond these techniques for evaluating any capital budgeting techniques. So these are the five methods of capital budgeting techniques.
Thank you, Professor Anand Pawar sir. Yes, very rightly said, any capital budgeting investment decision is a long term investment decision, and also sir has explained us the different five different techniques which we normally use in capital budgeting. So in continuation with what Professor Anand Pawar has sir, may I ask Ravi Kumar sir, is there any time preference considered sir while using capital budgeting techniques?
Yes, you know, time is very much important when you are making capital budgeting techniques. There are cash flows, and these cash flows are to be viewed taking into consideration the time preference for money.
Right.
Now, we cannot decide the things in terms of finance, we cannot decide the things excluding the time. So the time preference has to be considered here. What is the time preference? People prefer to keep money now than at a later stage. Now, if you ask them to part with their money for a number of period, like let's say number of years, 5 years, for 5 years, they expect an incentive. If you want them to keep their money with you, they expect an incentive. We call that interest rate. So this is for the reason money has a distinct feature that with the passage of the time, its value comes down. What is today 1,000 rupees will not be the same 1,000 rupees, I mean to say intrinsic value, after 1 year it will not be same. It will be less, it may be 950 or 970 or it may be 990 also, but it will be less than what is today. So therefore, all the cash flows in the project arising, coming into the company, all those cash flows to be discounted using a discount rate. What is the discount rate? This time preference rate. Now, then you may ask me a question, what about the cash outflows? Because we are spending the money now, the cash flows, you need not apply the time preference, because the 1,000 rupees value, intrinsic value now, today is 1,000 rupees. So therefore, you need not bring down this 1,000 rupees. What you had to do is, the future cash flows are to be brought to the present values, that is what called discounting. And you know, time preference is very much significant in capital budgeting.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir has very well explained us the discounting and non-discounting factors which we use in capital budgeting techniques. I again remind our viewers to interact and clarify your doubts. You can dial 040-270-31431, 040-270-31432, 040-270-31433. Please dial these number to interact and ask any question with our resource person. May I now ask Professor Anand Pawar sir, what is payback period method? How do we calculate payback period method and what are its merits and demerits, sir?
Thank you. Right. As it denotes, payback period, it is the number of years required to recover the original cash or outlay invested in a project. This payback period is all about, this method is simplest and easy to calculate, and most of the firms use it, because therefore it is, we consider it as most widely used method, payback period. Because when we are investing our huge amount into a project, how much we are going to get back and when we are going to get back is an important factor here. So whether it is after 1 year or 2 years or 3 years or 5 years, we have to calculate. So this method talks about how much and when you are going to get back your returns. This is the payback period which is required to recover initial investment. And a firm is always interested in knowing the amount of time required to recover the investment. Therefore, this concept, cash flow, and is a non-discounting technique. It is not discounting, as Dr. Ravi said, whatever we are investing today, we are talking about exact figures which we are investing today and how much we are going to get back tomorrow without any discounting factor. And therefore, this payback period can be calculated taking the initial investment and annual inflow of the investment. So, PBP is equal to initial investment by annual cash inflow. And under this method, there are two methods of calculating PBP. One is when we can calculate or use this technique, when we can use it, because when the project cash flow is uniform and non-uniform. For example, today we have invested 1 lakh rupees and after 1 year, we are going to get back 20,000 rupees, 20, 20, 20. See, inflow would be constant. Same amount will be generated after 1, 2, 3 or 4, whatever number of years that you are going to plan for. So, when you have this plan, initial investment by annual inflow will be the PBP. And when it comes to non-uniform cash flow, for example, same 1 lakh rupees we are investing today and next year we are going to get inflow as maybe 5,000, next year would be 7,000 and third year would be 8,000 or maybe 4,000 also. So, the when inflow is not equal or non-uniform, so we consider the payback period would be, calculation is same, but we have to consider whether this, the given problem is uniform cash inflow or non-uniform cash flow, the student has to take into account.
Yes.
So, therefore, this decision, because the capital budgeting decision start with PBP, is decision criteria would be like this. See, the finance manager would be making a decision rule here, because the decision criteria would be like this. When, if the there are only one project into consideration, when only one project is there for consideration, the decision or the selection or rejection of the project is decided by the top manager, but not by the finance manager alone, because only one project is available. The selection criteria or decision criteria will be in the hands of top management, because the finance manager has to consider the payback period as per the management expectations. And in case of the projects or multiple or more than one, in case of more than one project, the project with lower payback period should be selected, because today we are investing 5 lakhs rupees and within 4 years or 3 years whether we are going to get back or not, we have to decide.
Yeah, so you want to get, you know, recoup as early as possible.
As early as possible. Yeah. Therefore, this method has several advantages over other methods.
I would like to add on point,
please.
Sir. The payback period is a conventional technique, agreed,
right.
But the thing is, to improve on this, you can apply the time preference rate also, the discount rate also you can apply to the payback period. That is, for the same cash flows, you can apply time preference rate and bring down those cash flows to the present value,
right.
Then calculate the payback period. So then I think that is more realistic than the conventional payback period.
Of course, we generally see,
yeah.
It depends on the organization and the freedom given to the finance manager.
Okay.
So, it is the discretion of the finance manager how to calculate. Ultimately, the finance manager's job is to, what you call, apprise the top management and get the things done.
Yeah.
So, because of these, all these, it gives lot of benefits, advantages over other methods, because it is easy to calculate and simple to understand by everyone. The expertise required for this method is not that much.
Correct.
So, it is useful in case of those industries where there is a lot of uncertainty is there or instability. As Dr. Ravi rightly said, the unexpected situations may arise, like COVID context. So, certain industries may get affected also. So, under this condition, this payback period would be more appropriate, what the financial manager generally consider. And the many firm wants to recover their investment as quickly as possible.
Yes.
So, the main intention of this method, because it intention is to recoup the investment as early as possible. So, this method is more appropriate for them to know how quickly they could get their investment back.
Yes.
And the next advantage or merit of this, strength of this method would be, it measures liquidity of the investment.
Yeah. Correct.
At the same time, there are limitations or demerits with this method, because this method does not consider time value of money, as Dr. Ravi said, because we are not going to discount what we are investing today and what we are going to get back tomorrow. Therefore, it is one of the weakness with this method. And this further, it is also, this method does not consider the risk associated with the project. And the management sometimes may neglect the cash in flow occurring after the payback period. For example, the according to this method, we try to recoup our investment as early as possible. But during first 5 years, the returns may not be more lucrative, but after the payback period, the project may yield better benefits.
Yes.
But this method is not going to consider this. This is the one limitation. And last limitation would be with this, it ignores interest factor, which is considered as very important in taking sound investment decisions. Therefore, in spite of all these limitations, but this method would give you to recoup the investment at the earliest possible. Therefore, most of the firms apply this technique because it is easy to calculate and simple to understand.
Thank you, Professor Anand Pawar, sir. We have a phone question ready. We have a call by our viewers. Shall we take the call,
sir? Yeah, please. Hello.
Hello. Yeah, Matande.
Yes, you can ask the question.
Okay.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Yes.
Okay.
Sir, just I want to see how an investment with the financial manager, if you can get up a hospital, if you ask for an investment for the simplest analysis, how you know that premium gives exchange of relevant things, like it's an investment and it's a long term investment, and it gives the returns, they will not come, and it all depends. But hospital requires
So to answer, because we are already on the job to describe these all methods, it would be appropriate only after attending these all techniques. But even then, now see, his question is like this. So under this condition, COVID context, if the hospital invest their huge amount in CRI machines or some other CT scan kind of things, so when there is no recovery immediately, generally when any business firm invest with a invention, what you can see, any investment will be made only with a view to generate profits or returns at the earliest possible. But it is not as easy as possible, because in certain cases, when this kind of situation arises, the payback period method may not be suitable.
And moreover, I would like to add on, sir, what you are saying, the capital budgeting technique, the next level if you go, there is risk adjusted capital budgeting, or risk management in capital budgeting, wherein you will try to incorporate all possible risks associated with a particular project. In spite of that, if you are, you know, it is beyond your, you know, risk circle, then the next option is insurance.
Right.
So that's only answer.
Yeah. Yeah. The thing is, right now, what we can say over a period of time, after 10 to 10, 10, 5 minutes, we would be able to answer, because through our discussion, he will find the answer. So when we are talking about the PBP and all that, so next topic, what would be the next topic?
Ravi Kumar, sir, what is ARR method? How do we calculate ARR, and what are its merits and demerits, sir?
ARR is accounting rate of return. It is called accounting rate of return. You are taking the profit from the financial statements. Financial statements are prepared from the profit is taken from the financial statements from the accounts, books of accounts. So therefore, the return that you are taking here is accounting rate of return, because the data is collected from records of accounts. Okay. Now, when it comes to calculation of accounting rate of return, now interchangeably, this is also called as average rate of return. One must not be confused. The formula for calculating the accounting rate of return is average annual return, average annual profit or income,
net interest
by
net profits.
Yeah, average annual net income by average investment. Then we'll come to the point, first one. What is average net income? Now, it is net income. Generally, operating profit is considered. Operating profit is earnings before interest and taxes. That is what generally considered. Now, this net income after taxes, EBIT minus tax gives you net income after taxes.
Right.
And this EBIT minus T is taken for the given period of time, 5 years or 10 years, whatever it is. By the number of years is used, then you will get the average net income after taxes. Then average investment. When it comes to average investment, what is the investment in the beginning? What is the investment at the end? And you take the total by two, you will get the average investment. So the average net income by average investment gives you accounting rate of return.
Now, to make it simple,
yeah,
net average net profits by average net investment, because to understand the story.
Yeah. So, you know, this is the most simplest way of telling. Now, if you would permit me, madam, like I think we do not have that much time.
10 minutes.
If you would permit me, we can simply quickly take some calculations, if you can permit me.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Okay. First year, you got 1 lakh income. Then after taxes, the net income is 50,000. Second year, you got the same procedure. And the second year net income is, let's say, 60,000. Third year, 80,000. Fourth year, 100,000. So all these incomes are taken together, divided with the number of years, that is 4 years, you get the average income. And likewise, when it comes to the investment, first year investment, you have spent 1 lakh and then 2 lakhs, 3 lakhs, 4 lakhs. So every year you are going on investing additional investment, and all the investment by the number of years, you will get the average investment. If there is no investment made in any of the years, you don't consider that. Okay, so that is how you will get the average investment.
Thank you, yes, Ravi sir. May I ask Anand Pawar sir, what is NPV? How do we calculate NPV? What is its merits and demerits, sir?
Thank you. So net present value method is one of the important modern methods of capital budgeting, where we consider discounting factor of the investment made today and revenue generated tomorrow. So when we talk about PBP and ARR method, what we already discussed, these methods do not take into account or consideration the time value of the money. Therefore, this is a strength with the NPV method.
Yes.
So, NPV takes into account the profitability and the time value of the money. And then, NPV method is a discounted cash flow technique, which compares cash inflow and cash outflow. In simple, to make it simple, the NPV is the difference between present value of future cash inflow and future cash outflow. Very simple. And equation is also like this. NPV is equal to PV of cash inflows minus PV of cash outflow or outlay. So this is what very simple. And decision, how to take a decision with regard to this technique is, if there is only one project under consideration, if NPV is positive, accept. If the NPV is negative, reject.
Simple.
This is simple. If there are more than one project, the project with higher NPV would be selected. Simple. And it has several advantages over other methods, because as we discussed, time value of money is considered and other, but even then, however, these technique also suffers with certain limitations.
Can I ask Ravi Kumar sir, what is IRR method? How do we calculate? What are its merits and demerits, sir?
In case of net present value, it is the difference between present value of cash inflows and present value of cash outflows. When it is IRR, you know, when you're doing the present, calculating present value of cash inflows and present value of cash outflows, you're using a discount rate. That itself is called as time preference rate. When it comes to IRR, you're not given a rate, but you have to calculate the rate. And that rate is the rate at which the present value of cash inflows and the present value of cash outflows are equal. The rate at which present value of cash inflow, present value of cash outflows are equal. So this is IRR. It is called IRR for the reason this rate is called internally. Therefore, it is internal rate of return. So when a project is selected, whichever project has highest internal rate of return, that project is more viable.
Thank you, sir. Sir Anand Pawar, sir, can you tell me what is profitability index? How do we calculate? What are its merits and demerits?
Yeah, it is another modern techniques of methods of capital budgeting. And this is based on NPV method again. Because
can Ravi Kumar, sir, please explain
so
what is...
Just let me brief and then Ravi will take up. Now, this profitability index is more focused on profitability of the project invested today. So before calculating profitability index method, the NPV value as it is will be considered, and then we proceed further calculations based on profitability of the firm. Therefore, it is extension and little superior than NPV method what we generally consider. And therefore, we call it, there are certain merits and demerits. Dr. Ravi will add
to this. Most widely techniques are net present value and IRR. But profitability index, just like payback period, it is more easy to understand. Even layman can understand. It is simply the ratio between the present value of cash outflows and present value of cash inflows, or we can say present value of cash inflows and present value of cash outflows. If the rate is more than one, it is accepted. That means you should be able to recoup all the money that you're spending. If you're spending 10 crores, you should be able to recoup at least 10 crores. Only then you can proceed with the project. So profitability index is improved version and more simplified version of NPV. The NPV. Yeah. And even IRR, it
limitation.
Sir, having discussed some of the important issues of capital budgeting and their sectoral suitability, I would like to ask Professor Anand Pawar, what factors determine the capital budgeting decision, sir?
Yeah. See, any decision, whether it is short term or long term, particularly when we talk about capital budgeting decisions, there are several factors to be considered because of its nature, because huge capital we are investing. So, the one major factor which are going to determine the decision of capital budgeting is availability of funds. See whether the firm has sufficient funds available with them or not. So if it is less amount of resources available, then go for which is suitable project and small project. If you use, then you can go for multiple projects or large projects. So one factor would be availability of funds, and next would be objectives of the capital budgeting, because the firm has any objectives to go for capital budgeting or not. For example, certain organizations may not be going for beyond their scope. So then this factor will hindrance the firm not to go for huge projects. Then another factor would be capital structure of the investing firm. So what type of capital that they have, and then working capital, because the some firms, they may require huge amount for working capital, then they may not be going for capital investment. Therefore, working capital determines the capital investment decisions. So, next one is capital returns. See, any investment would be expecting returns. See, how much returns that we are going to generate out of this project. So, returns generated from this project is also one of the factor which is determining, and earnings and the need of the project, whether the project going to be taken is need of the or for this organization or not. And lending policies of the financial institution, because always firms cannot invest their own funds, because every organization may not be available with their fund available with them. Therefore, always we have to depend on financial institutions, and therefore the financial institutions policies towards the lending is also one of the criteria or factor which determines capital investment decisions. And accounting methods, which accounting method that the firm is applying for estimating or appraising their capital investment decisions, and that accounting method is supposed to be in consultation, or which is most suitable for those financial institutions. Because some financial, for example, Indian banking accounting system may not be taken by some foreign investment companies. So that accounting decisions is also, methods also important. And last but not the least, government policy and taxation policy is also very important. So whether the government is encouraging such projects or not, it decides the capital investment decisions.
Yeah.
And likewise, we can go on adding the factors which are determining the investment decisions.
So, dear viewers, probably you had a very exciting journey today on today's topic of capital budgeting techniques. I thank all the viewers, I thank all the resource persons, technicians, Doordarshan Kendra Yadagiri for extending their valuable support. Thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you so much.